Welcome, everyone. It's really nice to see you all come out today, and we've got a bigger crowd. I think this has been our biggest crowd so far, so thank you. I'd like to now share some history with you on the Samus Teepee, this wonderful structure, and how it came to be in Medicine Hat. You will notice the sign at, or the monument at the front that's dedicated to Amerigo Filanti. I knew him as Rick, and Rick came to this country from Italy. He immigrated here. He found a beautiful Alberta gal to marry, and he raised his family, and he did quite well for himself. And he wanted to give something back to his adopted country. But it wasn't until after the 1988 Winter Olympics that he could realize his dream. And that was when they put a lot of the artifacts from the Olympics up for sale. And his wife had heard on the radio that the Olympic teepee that stood over the McMahon Stadium, over the athletes, was going up for sale. So Rick put a bid in of $100,000. But that wasn't the highest bid. There was a Texas firm that I think they bid over $200,000 for the Olympic teepee. But the engineer, Steve Ellis, he liked the name Medicine Hat, and he wanted the teepee to stay here in Canada, and in Alberta particularly. So Mr. Filanti, he got the winning bid. And that's how we got the teepee here. But what came from the Olympics are these two main trusses. The rest was all engineered and manufactured here in the city. Now there's 800 tons of cement in the base of the teepee and 200 tons of steel. And these are the same, like the pipes that are used in like Trans-Canada Pipeline. Those are the same pipes. Now it's built to withstand winds of 200 kilometers an hour, and it's built to stand for 500 years. So it was manufactured and it was erected. They had to be so precise in their measurements that if they had been an inch out at the base, they'd have been an inch or a foot out at the top. So that's how precise they had to be. There's more of an engineering challenge in this teepee than the Eiffel Tower. So it's quite an engineering marvel that we have here. Now, why did they pick this site here? Well, it ties in with the Samus archaeological site in the valley below, and that's a protected site. And back in 1970, a local woman, Babs Congram, she was walking along the cut banks, the creek there, and there was a lot of bone and artifacts sticking out. So she contacted the City of Calgary and they, the University of Calgary, and they put her in touch with Dr. Laurie Milne, who was an alum from Calgary, University of Calgary, and she was working at the Medicine Hat College. So in the early 70s, she did an extensive excavation of the site with her students, and that told a lot about what the site was used for, and it was determined that it was a late winter, early spring meat processing site. So a lot of bison bone, fecal bison bone was uncovered, and that told that the valley provided a lot of protection. There was a lot of other animals that they had harvested, deer, antelope, there was bear, Richardson ground squirrel, and it also told how far they traveled and who their trading partners were. Because of the impact of civilization, they did get a lot of artifacts from the 1500s, the 1700s, and all of this information was gathered, and Dr. Laurie Milne published it in the Museum of Man, Museum of Mercury series in Ottawa. So it's all been published and it's there. Now, this teepee, you notice the doorway, it faces east, and that's because teepees generally, the doorways face east because the first thing you wanted to see in the morning was the rising of the sun, and that's the giver of life. The white on the teepee, that's for purity. The blue is for the flowing waters, and the red is for the rising and setting of the sun. Now, we have here our storyboards. The originals, we had put a call out in the early 90s for artists to submit, and themes were chosen by the Samus Storyboard Committee, and artists from across Canada submitted their submissions on what they interpreted the meanings to be, and these were the what people that won, and they were put up. It's kind of a unique way that they were done. The originals are a 3-foot circular drawing, and we had to figure out a way, because these are 9 feet, I believe, or 10-foot storyboards. We had to figure out a way how to get their painting up on this teepee. And actually, I was given that task. I worked for the Teepee Association at the time, and I had contacted the different signage companies in town, and it was Grant from City Signs that said 3M's got a product that we could, you know, we get color transfers of the original storyboards, we send it to the 3M company in the States, and they sent us back, they go up like a wallpaper. But we had done this in 94, that's when they went up, and they were replaced this year by the city, so they're nice and new, and looks like they'll last for 20 years, because 22 years it's been since we've had them replaced. Another unique feature of the teepee is the storyboard's drumming. When the weather changes, they give off a loud boom. Now the engineers, when they put it up, they said, well, we could drill a hole in there and take that out. We said, no, that's a way for the teepee to welcome people. When the drums go off, when the weather changes, for the teepee to welcome people to this area. Another unique feature about this teepee is the acoustics. In the middle, it's very clear and sharp, and that's because it bounces off the tubing. So it's very nice right here in the middle for acoustics. The first storyboard, that tells the legend of how Medicine Hat got its name, and that comes from a very old legend from the Blood Tribe. And that tells of Eagle Birth. He fell in love with another man's wife, so he had to leave the Belly Buttes around Lethbridge, and he came here. He had his visions. The merman came to him in his visions, and he received the gift of the eagle tail feather headdress. The otter came to him, and so you'll see a teepee on there, and the otter became his totem, and he was allowed to put the otter symbol on the outside of his teepee. At the bottom, you'll see the merman's world, and the merman lives in the South Saskatchewan. So that's a sacrifice that Eagle Birth had to give to the merman. And from giving that sacrifice, Eagle Birth became a great hunter and took his wife back to the Belly Buttes and asked for forgiveness and brought a lot of gifts. And that's the story. Now, oh, they're missing something off that. There should be on that storyboard Jeremy Ostrowski after Joseph Heinbull, because the original painting was done in a rectangular format, and it was done by Joseph Heinbull. But before Joseph could put it in the circular format, he had passed away. So a local artist, Jeremy Ostrowski, took his work and did it into the circular format. So I'm going to invite you just to go along after, and there's storyboards for there's writing on for all of the storyboards to look at. So once again, welcome, and we won't delay anymore. We'll get the dancing started.